This episode is sponsored by World of Tanks, and we look at the most controversial Panzer of the Second World War, the Panzerkampfwagen 5 Panther. For this we use footage from the restored Samur Panther, and also in-game footage as well. Recently I took a closer look at the Panther, and it is quite interesting to see the different opinions. Even experts sometimes disagree quite a bit. As such, I had a little chat with Dr. Roman Töppel about the issue, and he made an excellent point. He noted, what is often forgotten by various assessments is what the crewmen thought about the Panther during the war. He already had collected various excerpts from reports and other sources, which he kindly provided to me for this video. Additionally, World of Tanks approached me and gave me the opportunity to interview the curator, Lieutenant Colonel Pierre Garnier de la Barrière, and the driver and tank mechanic, Richard Ledomier, of the French Tank Museum at Samur, which recently restored the Panther Bretagne to working conditions again. And since these men have experience with other World War II tanks as well, they can provide a good comparison and other insights. Yet, let's start with the German assessment. The first major action the Panther saw was at the Battle of Kursk in 1943. One main issue was that the Panther was rushed towards the front line and had still many teething problems, or Kinderkrankheiten as we see in German. So let's hear what the soldiers noted. On armor protection and survivability, a report from the 8th of July 1943 of the Panzerregiment 39 noted, the Panzerkampfwagen Panther has never been penetrated in the front despite the strongest fire and numerous hits. However, when fired vertically at the side from a distance of up to 1500 meters, penetrations occur, with caliber 7.62 cm also on the inclined surfaces of the upper part of the hull side and on the turret. Flanking fire from a close distance must therefore be avoided as far as possible. This assessment is repeated several times by other reports or war diaries entries, for instance the 48th Panzer Corps. Yet there were other issues in terms of protection and survivability. A report by Guderian from July about the Panzerregiment 39 noted that the Panther easily caught fire and that the hatches were bad. A lieutenant colonel after the Battle of Kursk noted similarly, Lukendeckel Fehlkonstruktion, which means faulty hatch cover design. These points refer to the fact that the hatches of the driver and radio man tended to jam. As such, they were usually kept open during combat. Now some issues with the Panther starting to burn easily were related to the teething problems, like leaky seals. Yet some of these issues were still present in 1944, as noted by a Panzer regiment on an action of the 9th of June 1944, shortly after D-Day. The 3rd Company had lost 7 tanks in its first attack. The loss rate to the burn surprised us at first. We found out that the Panzer V burned exceptionally easily. Next, let's look at the firepower. In this era the Panther shined. The troops are very happy with the long-barreled 7.5 cm Kampfwagenkanone 42. It provided a very high muscle velocity, which not only allowed for high penetration values, but also a flat trajectory. As such, hitting was easier. An entry into the war diary of the 48th Panzer Corps notes, the Panther's cannon is a complete success, firing point fire at the furthest distance with excellent penetration. There was although an issue that was related to the gun, however. The firing observation by the commander is considerably impaired by the powder gases, even with the cupola open, too much biting powder gases accumulate there. This was despite the fact that the Panther had a bore evacuator, a device that should remove the gases from the loading area of the gun. Note, unlike modern bore evacuators, it was not a passive device, but used a compressor. Now it would be logical to look at mobility and driving behavior next, an element of the Panther that is usually mentioned positively by various authors, in various ways, and also within the report of the Soviet trials from 1943. The hydraulic servo makes steering the tank easy. It is necessary to evaluate the servo's performance in the winter. Yet there's a small issue in Dr. Töppel's notes, since mobility is not explicitly mentioned. Now there might be several reasons for this. One could be that the drivers were not really asked. Another could be that in combat it all comes down to combat effectiveness. As such, mobility is only an issue if it's extremely good or so bad that it has a negative effect on combat performance. In other words, it is only mentioned if there was a problem. As such, I assume that there was no particular issue with the Panther's mobility when it was working properly. Which of course brings us to the next point, reliability, or the lack thereof. Referring again to the report of the Panzerregiment 39 from the 8th of July 1943, it notes, at the Panzer Battalion 52, so far 60 tanks have broken down due to technical failure. According to Jens, each battalion should have had 96 Panthers. And Operation Citadelle started on the 5th of July. So in 4 days, 60 tanks had technical issues. This means an average breakdown of 15 Panthers per day. Some of this might have been related to improper training, yet this was clearly not the main reason. Of course, it just made the situation worse. It should be noted that nearly every weapon system at its introduction has various problems. The issue with the Panther was that it was also rushed towards the front. Yet the often repeated claim that Hitler delayed Operation Citadelle for waiting for Panthers and Tigers is an oversimplification. For further information on this, be sure to check out the discussion of Dr. Roman Töppel and me on my second channel. Similar to modern authors, the Panther even during wartime had its fans and detractors. For instance, one officer noted in a draft of a report in October 1943, Panther, preferably assault guns and Panzer IV. Whereas a brigade commander noted about the experiences during the Battle of Kursk, in general, it can be said that the Panther is a very good vehicle in spite of several startup illnesses, and the motor is still too vulnerable. Now one aspect the veterans did not, or better could not really cover during wartime, was how the Panther compared to foreign tanks. Yet, luckily the team of the French Tank Museum at Saumur has quite some experience with other World War II tanks. And as such we interviewed two of them at Tankfest 2019 about the various issues like driving, maintenance, the good, the bad, and what they would change, assuming they would be using the Panther during World War II. Let's hear what the driver and tank mechanic Richard has to say. One of the key questions was how the Panther is different from other World War II tanks he has experience with. He noted it is far easier to drive, or in his own words,
l'avantage du Panther, c'est à conduire, il est relativement facile par rapport à un char de la même masse. La direction est assistée par un système hydraulique et entraîné par sous la tourelle il y a une pompe hydraulique et donc on force presque pas pour tourner le char contrairement à un Sherman où il faut forcer sur les freins beaucoup plus. Les Renault français aussi ont le même système que les Sherman, donc ça demande plus de force pour tourner alors qu'un Panther par exemple est assisté parfaitement.
When it comes to maintenance, Richard is quite favorable about the Panther in comparison to other tanks he has experience with.
La maintenance sur un Panther c'est assez imposant parce que le moteur par exemple pèse 1,5 tonnes, ça nécessite des gros moyens pour l'entretien, donc sortir le moteur, mais c'est accessible, il y a une grosse trappe, contrairement à certains autres chars où il faut défaire une grosse partie, la tourelle, le blindage, pour accéder au moteur par exemple, pour les gros entretiens. Donc le char était relativement pensé pour les entretiens accessibles et faciles.
Yet the main weakness of the Panther, according to literature, is also an issue for the team at Saumur.
On a le même problème actuellement sur le final drive. Il faut toujours régler, l'usure est très importante. À chaque fois qu'on le fait fonctionner, il faut toujours recontrôler le réglage. Je pense qu'à l'usage durant la guerre, ça devait être encore pire. Donc oui, ça devait être un problème récurrent.
Finally, we ask Richard about what he likes and dislikes about the Panther.
Alors le Panther, ce que j'aime beaucoup, c'est justement la facilité de conduite. Il est très assisté, il a une puissance remarquable. Et pour tourner le char, c'est vraiment simple. Ce que j'aime moins, c'est le manque de visée. On a une petite trappe. C'est pour la sécurité, c'est un peu moins bien. Mais dans la majorité des cas, il n'y a que du bon.
Now let's listen to the thoughts of the curator of the Tank Museum, Lieutenant Colonel Pierre Garnier de Lavalliere. We ask specifically about the transmission and steering, since that is a weak point often mentioned in the literature.
Les transmissions sur le Panther étaient certainement le point le plus faible de ce char. Et nous, actuellement, on a des problèmes pour régler justement le déplacement avec les bandes. Et donc à chaque démarrage, on doit faire des petits réglages en bougeant un tout petit peu les chenilles pour voir si les réglages que l'on a fait sont encore bons. Et chaque fois, on doit revoir le réglage.
Now the next question is about the three elements the Lieutenant Colonel would change if he would have to use the pant in a World War II combat scenario.
La première chose que je changerais, c'est le moteur. Le moteur est un moteur de très bonne qualité, d'une grande technicité, mais qui est très compliqué. Donc je pense que c'est surtout et avant tout le moteur que l'on changerait. Ensuite, après, c'est le système de transmission, effectivement, qui nécessite une amélioration importante. Et avec le changement du moteur, ce qui permettait d'avoir une plus faible consommation, donc une présence sur le terrain plus importante. Donc c'est un petit peu ces trois pièces-là que je changerai. Avec le moteur, ça sera, permettrait d'avoir une plus grande autonomie sur le terrain et donc pouvoir mieux combattre.
To conclude, although the Panther had serious issues during the Battle of Kursk, the reports are very positive when it came to the frontal armor protection and the firepower. Mobility was usually not an issue within the reports, likely because it was not a major concern to begin with and there were no substantial issues. Although some reliability issues could be ironed out during the course of the war, the Panther was still quite a problematic cat. Of course, for a museum operating and conserving tanks, armor protection and firepower are less of an issue. Whereas the driving quality is a major concern. Here the Panther stands out, and although the argument can be made that it was less tiring for the driver, it is questionable if this had a major influence on effectiveness. Since on long marches the driver can be replaced, and in combat there are usually plenty of stops. Especially interesting were the remarks of the Lieutenant Colonel that he would upgrade the engine's efficiency to achieve a longer operational time in combat, since I haven't come across that aspect yet. It also relates to the fact that the Panther is more comfortable to steer as mentioned by the driver. And speaking of driving tanks, this brings us to the sponsor of this episode, the free-to-play game World of Tanks, which financially supported the restoration of the Panther tank and also Tankfest. Now if you want to get started with World of Tanks, they provide a special code for new players that gives them immediate access to the T27 tank, 500 gold premium currency, and 7 days of premium time, if you use the link in the description. World of Tanks features over 500 tanks, including the Panzerkampfwagen 6 Tiger, the T-34, the Sherman, the Matilda, and the S-35. So if you want to ambush one or more of the million players worldwide, head on in. Of course, you can also charge in and deal it out up close and personal, since World of Tanks allows for many different playstyles. Big thank you to World of Tanks for sponsoring this episode. Be sure to check out the link in the description. A big thank you to Lieutenant Colonel Pierre Garnier de Lavalle, Richard Ledemoyer, Dr. Roman Töppel, Philip, David, Krasimir, and Military Aviation History for making this video possible. Special thanks to the Tank Museum for inviting me to Tankfest 2019. As always, source the link in the description. Thank you for watching and see you next time.